Mitzi Smith, full professor of New Testament and Early Christian Studies at Ashland Theological Seminary. The book I recently published with Cascade is I Found God in Me, a Womanist Biblical Hermeneutics Reader. I felt inspired to write this book. I was actually on study leave, working on another project, and it just came to me. You've written a few womanist articles. There is not a reader in womanist biblical interpretation, and you can pull one together. And so I began putting out emails to other women I knew that were doing biblical interpretation, womanist biblical interpretation, and I got enough responses, I felt, to do the volume, start it with classic articles that have already been written by womanist scholars, primarily biblical scholars, right? And so toward the end of that study leave, I put out a proposal to Wipf and Stock. They accepted it, and in a relatively short time, I was able to pull this volume together. Womanism is an approach that privileges the experiences, voices, traditions, and artifacts of African, primarily African American women, although there are other women of color who call themselves womanists, and primarily outside of the study of religion. In terms of biblical interpretation, we as scholars take a particular perspective, African American females' perspective, privileging our voices. We don't say our voices are not the same, but we do have things in common, right? And so we privilege our concerns, our voices, our traditions, and read biblical texts from that standpoint, from that hermeneutical framework. Different from feminists. We do not primarily and sometimes only concerned with gender, but we are concerned with gender, race, class as intersectional realities that impact women of color. Womanist biblical interpretation was first coined in the Academy of Religion by Katie Cannon, who's an ethicist. The first womanists were ethicists and theologians. But the term originates from Alice Walker's In Our Mother's Garden. She also has an essay that was written prior to that 1983 book in 1979. But a fuller definition of womanism or womanist is in Alice Walker's In Search of Our Mother's Garden. And it's a three-pronged definition. And it includes the fact that a womanist is from folk people's understanding, the average woman's understanding, the term originates from the notion that you are acting womanish, right? That you are audacious, that you are courageous, that you are bold, and further, that womanists are concerned with entire community, that like Harriet Tubman, I will set out in search of my freedom, but I will take a lot of other folks with me. Right? And so that definition can be found more broadly in that volume. But womanists have also expanded, as we continue to do the work, we have also expanded that definition to focus on certain aspects of Black women's lives, like Black Lives Matter in terms of contemporary concerns and so forth. Context always matters, I say, when we're doing interpretation, right? And for me, for example, teaching out of the Detroit metro area, one contextual concern is the right to clean, affordable drinking water. Right? We've had instances of people not being able to afford the rising cost of water, or people not having access to clean water, as in Flint, Michigan. And, for example, I have read, not in this volume, but probably in the volume coming up for Cascade, I've read the story of the encounter between Jesus and the Samaritan woman through the lens of the Flint water crisis and the fact that people have a right, as the UN has said, have a right to affordable clean water, right? And so we take those concerns, contemporary concerns that impact our community and the larger global community, and we use them as a framework for reading texts, right, for selecting a text to read that would allow us to address that concern, those particular concerns. I think every perspective brings its own set of questions, or different questions, right? And if I'm reading, for example, I'm concerned with, in I Found God in Me, one of the essays is reading virginity and the notion of a woman as a prostitute or a whore, right? And so when I look at Matthew and I look at Revelation beginning, ending with this idea of the whore of Babylon, or close to the end of that text, and Matthew beginning with the notion of a pure virgin and so forth, right? One being the beginning of the New Testament, one being the end. And I'm thinking about how these categories have had even a more negative impact on Black women and poor women's lives, right? For example, in Africa, you have the problem, and other parts of the world where people are dealing with the epidemic of AIDS, that you can somehow cure AIDS, this false assumption, by having sex with a virgin. And so young girls and so forth are being raped and attacked and are not safe. But we are really dealing with a construction. And we can look at the text, bring that question, that issue, that problem to the text, and look how also this is happening in the biblical text. And there may very well be connections between what people have read in biblical text, what has been constructed, right? Women being constructed as virgins and as whores, and how that impacts people in contemporary societies, right? Those ideologies that get transferred from the text to society, and vice versa, right? So reading from a different perspective means you bring questions that maybe other people will not bring to the text, questions people will not ask about the text. Concerns that they would otherwise overlook, right? Oh, this is just, this is the way it is, this is the way it should be, right? It's in sacred text, and so we shouldn't question it. But these categories are having negative impact on the lives of women, and particularly poor women and women of color. During this session at the SBL, I was invited to do a paper on Luke Acts, right? And the construction in the Acts of the Apostles of the Ethiopian eunuch and the Alexandrian Jew Apollos, right, had been gnawing at me for some time. And my late dissertation advisor from Harvard, Francois Bovan, really affirmed the significance of intuition. And this, I had an intuition at this text. And so I brought to this week, to this session, a presentation on how we can see the eunuch and the Apollos as two parallel characters, right? This has never been suggested in Luke Acts studies at all, right? But they are both constructed as the ethnic other, right? They are the ethnic other who are in a sense conquered through their conversion through non-apostles who have already been subordinate to the major 12 apostles. And they represent two countries that Rome wanted to conquer, right? Because of wealth, Ethiopian wealth, wisdom attached to that one, Alexandria in Egypt as an intellectual cultural center, and Rome did conquer Alexandria in 30 BCE, but was not able to conquer Ethiopia. Right, it remained a problem for the Roman Empire. But in these narratives, these two characters that symbolically represent those two countries are conquered through one-way knowledge, right? Both of them have to be taken aside by under apostles and taught one way of reading the text. And this can have an impact on how the ethnic other is seen, right, as the person who must be taught and the person who is in some way inferior, regardless of what that we may, the cultural and material capital they may have, right, that there's a way to keep them, to continue to see them as some way inferior and to be conquered. Right. And so the dominant powers to be, right, they value and they desire those things like wealth and knowledge that they have, but they also fear them, and which is seen in the conquering of them. And so that's the way I'm reading those two texts, right? And so the construction of the ethnic other, the foreign other, right, as something to be feared and conquered, we see throughout the text, throughout the biblical text, right? The biblical text has been grist for the meal, right? For that of the dominant culture being superior and needing to teach everybody else, and especially the ethnic other. There's so many people who, you know, as a minister, you know, in the church, and as a person who teaches in a seminary, there are many people even those who are not in the church, there are people who some are giving up on the church, but still have been impacted by the Bible. Right, and govern their lives by what they think the Bible says, right? Whether it be true or false, right? And so they, based on the way they read the Bible and on the ways they've been told the Bible reads, it impacts the ideologies, right? That they get from those readings. It impacts their lives and how they interact with other people who are different, who are the same. There is a need to critically read the text, right? And to help communities critically read the text so that we can still claim the Bible as an authoritative sacred text, but more so the God that we find in the Bible that we say is just and that we say is loving, right? To reclaim, to ferret out, to mine the text, right, for that which will allow us and help us to live in relation to other people in just and loving ways, right? Because a lot of times we are living by what somebody told us about the Bible, and a lot of times that information is information that causes us to be oppressive toward others. It maybe even causes us to be, in a sense, schizophrenic, because it is oppressive to us as well, but we have not learned to think about it more critically. I think womanist biblical interpretation is necessary because it brings a different set of questions, right, that otherwise may not get answered, right? It brings a different set of eyes, and not that all of our eyes are the same, but it brings generally the more people with different concerns, different questions, coming out of different contexts that can come to the table, the more the different questions that get answered, right? The different concerns that get addressed, right? And so if everybody that's coming to the table is a white male, for example, or even a white female, their concerns, their questions get addressed, right? And questions that need to be addressed in order that we can live together in a society that respects all voices, that is concerned with the predicament of the least of these among us, right? We need more and more indifferent voices at the table. Even with the case of the story of the reading of the Ethiopian eunuch, right? You normally in the Luke Acts section, it is predominantly white males and maybe a few white females predominantly, right? No one had asked that question or even thought to bring those two characters together. So it takes people in order to critique how the ethnic other in these texts are being treated in the same way, right? It takes somebody who is coming from a different perspective, from a different context, have different concerns, and has a concern about those, the impact of those at the margins, right? And for sure, we coming out of the academy, we all come from somewhat of a privileged place in terms of our education, right? But if we are engaged in the wider context and with those who are less privileged, and try to keep in mind those who are less privileged, we can't totally speak for them, but we can bring some of their concerns to the table too if we desire. Womanists bring that different, a variety of methods to the interpretation. I mean, most of us have been trained in the academy, so we will use some historical critical methods, but we will normally not privilege the text first, right? But we will privilege the experiences, the voices, the artifacts, and the and sometimes that overlaps because the Bible is an artifact of the African American experience as well. But do we privilege it? No, because we believe the text, that whatever reading we end up with, whatever interpretation, that it must be relevant, right? Not just to the academy, but to real flesh and blood readers who are living, as Howard Thurman would say, with their backs against the wall.